Okay, this is the first turn on of the Pomera DM20 by King Jim. They no longer make these. They were only for sale in Japan. The Japanese electronics market is a lot more interesting than ours. They will experiment with things that most people would say, why in the world would I buy that? All it does is type letters. I can do that on my phone, my iPad, my laptop. Well, the Japanese gave it a shot. And now I'm introducing it, because there's loads of them still in stock in Japan, introducing it to America. You can find these sometimes on Amazon for as little as $120 from Japan, still brand new. It will take a while for shipping. I went ahead and used a company that has a better reputation on Amazon and paid for EMS to get it here. I ordered it last Thursday. They shipped it Saturday. I got it today on Wednesday. Anyway, I've put in AA batteries and we're going to go through a first turn on together. Center this so we can see. I don't read Japanese. I'm guessing this is the power button because it's got a ridge around it. One, two, well, it's already ready to write. I couldn't even count to two. It has an internal clock. It has a battery indicator. There's something flashing there. I don't know what it means. But it's already in English. Menu. There's a way to stop it from underlining. Oh, it's turning to Japanese now. Oh, I have to hold down the mitt. It's acting a little weird. It's been on a long flight. How do we... arrows, okay. This is of course all in Japanese. I don't understand it. So we hit the menu button to get the menu up. We're going arrow keys all the way to the left where there's supposed to be an option for language. Is it this one? Yes, it is. The last one on the right, to the very bottom. Click on English. And now everything's in English. Isn't that awesome? Okay, part two. A lot of frustrations I had at the beginning was number one, not being able to understand Japanese, of course, but I've come to realize that this is not a computer, so it's computer processor that runs everything is of course very, very slow and weak. So a lot of the times you make choices to update something or change something, it takes a while for it to catch on, let's say. So I'm starting with a new document here. Let's make sure it's brand new. And we'll just start typing and see what it looks like. Because the camera's in front of me, it's a little difficult to type. see it comes in still underlined, but those little markings are not in front of the screen anymore. What I found out is when you save a file, let's say we'll save this here. When you hit enter, the line will disappear. I guess the line is under it, telling you that you're working on that line. And when you want to go to menu and you save it, when yesterday comes again, for some reason the letter A is not working. It has these weird little quirks. Like, it takes a while to figure out what you're doing anyway. I don't know what inserting line feed codes means, but I click on yes. It'll save it. Oops, back in Japanese again. But anyway, things like word wrap and all that kind of stuff sort of fixed itself. When you're typing a brand new document, when it gets to the end of the line, you might have to keep clicking the enter key to continue typing. When you save the file, even if it's only a few words like I just did, when you save the file and then reopen it, all those problems seem to go away. So I guess you save the settings in the file too, and then you don't have to word wrap so much. I updated it. I still don't know what this flashing thing is. I don't know what that means. But, couple of things I found out. Number one, it does not have Bluetooth. You have to get the newer DM100 if you want the Bluetooth keyboard. But I like this one because it's very portable, and throw it in a jacket pocket. Open it up wherever you are. I have tested typing on my lap. It wasn't that bad. I updated the software, which means I put a micro SD card in here. I thought this model only handled up to 2 gigabytes, but I put in a 4 gigabyte SD card and it did recognize it as 4 gigabytes, which is pretty much all the storage anybody would ever need on a device like this. Updating it meant plugging it into the computer. Then I had to go to the Pomera website. I had to search a lot online, and a lot of that stuff isn't in English, even when you translate the page. I was able to figure out which the download button was. I was able to download the software. I put the software first onto my old IBM laptop. It comes in a zip file, so you unzip it. And then you put the BIN file onto the SD card. You have to have an SD card to do this. When you plug this device into your PC and your PC recognizes the drives, you take the BIN file, you put it, transfer it to the SD card, and then you tell the device to update. It'll want to stay connected to your computer to do that. But it updated the file. It took about 5 or 6 minutes. As I said, a very slow processor. And everything seems to be working good. Okay, we'll call this part 3. You know, I'll put all these together as one video. There was definitely a few quirks that had to be figured out. In case anybody buys one of these, let me save you some time by pointing out some of these quirks to you. get this angle so you can kind of see the screen. Let me start with a new document. When you start typing a brand new document, a brand new, this time it happens to be in Japanese. The caps key is what switches between English and Japanese. There we are, it's typing a brand new document. Now, sometimes when you begin a brand new document, the line will be underneath the words. All you do is hit the Enter key, and it will stop that. And sometimes when you hit the Enter key, it'll jump back into Japanese, so you just have to press the Caps key again. I know it sounds annoying, but you only have to ever do it once. Once you get a couple of words in there and hit the Enter, and then a Caps lock to bring it back to English, the line disappears, it's in English, and you don't ever have to do the caps lock thing or the enter key again once in that document. And also, once you have saved a document, it's asked me, do I want to file save this? No. When yesterday comes again, chapter one, I'm going to open. Once you've saved a document, you can pick up right where you left off. You don't have to do the enter key and the tab to get it back in English again. Yeah, so it's a decent little typing device. One thing I haven't tested, which I will now, is after you've written a bit, you have to save the file or will it automatically save the file? So I'm going to power it off and then power it back on and see if it saved everything I wrote automatically. It did. It's still there. Awesome. But of course, paranoid as a writer, you don't want to lose what you wrote. So I always go through the save process. Doubly so. And there we go. When you're done with your, you can have multiple files. I have not written enough yet to see how big this file can be. But let's see, 1, 2, 3. I'm well between 2 and 3 full typewritten pages in already and haven't come up a brick wall yet. Anyway, if there's anything new I learn about it or anything I need to update on, I'll make another video in the future. I just wanted to quickly make this part 3 to tell you everything was working fine, in case anybody's considering one. And I wanted to film it tonight so I could add it to parts 1 and 2 and make one full video and put it online on YouTube. So it's time for me to go to the computer and do some editing. Thanks for watching. So as I was putting all my video together and transferring them into movie format for my 2006 iMac, do the converting, I realized I didn't really have any film of me actually using the device for a couple of minutes. I know when I watch review videos, especially review videos about actually using devices, I actually like to see people used the device. So I'm just going to add a couple of minutes of me actually just sitting here typing away at the end of this review video. Start in Japanese again, caps lock, problem solved. So that's another paragraph in there. I'm still at a my writing process is generally to do a very short outline type of basic synopsis of a story, and then I will I generally like to write long outlines by hand, and then do most of my freestyle writing by hand before putting it into a device like this. So this device has come a couple of weeks early. I'm still in the handwriting process. But just out of interest, in case anybody who's wondering what the book is, I've always had trouble with the idea of writing a novel a few hundred pages long. I know most writers, especially when they start out, just try to grab an hour or two in the evening when they can, and some hours on the weekend. I just have a lot of difficulty with that. I need a big block of time. In fact, the first time I wrote the novel in its entirety, at about 300 pages, the big story I'm working on, I was unemployed at the time. I was a construction worker and I was going through a period of unemployment. And it took about a week or two to get into the writing habit, and then I banged out the book in a couple of weeks. It's nowhere near good enough, but of course, the guy's got to go back to work. But then the guy, the writer, Hugh Howey, kind of inspired me. He came out with a little 38-page book called Wool, and that book pretty much has launched his career. He's now very well known, and he's turned that little 38-page book into three huge books in the Wool series. But it gave me an idea. My 300-page novel does not have to come out as 300 pages. If I can get 50 to 80 good pages in a mini story that stands alone, I can break the book up into parts, and the beginning of my book happens to work as a standalone story at about 60 or 70 pages. So that's what I'm doing here. So I just thought I'd read a little bit and get your opinion if it sounds like a real book. The only woman in the world wakes to the sound of thunder. The cave she makes her home, shaking in tune with the violence of the storm outside. She throws off her dinosaur skin blanket and rises, naked, to her feet. Her long brown hair out of control, her breath white in the frigid air. She dresses in what she still has left of her uniform. Green cargo pants shredded below the knees, and an army jacket with no sleeves. There is nothing else, shoes, socks, and underwear long since worn away. Tying her hair behind her head with a strip of leather, she reveals a face most fashion models would die for. The woman walks to the cave's entrance, pushing aside a door made of leather and bone. She looks out into the freezing rain, not reacting as it hits her in the face, watching as lightning illuminates the forest treetops 100 feet below. Her cave is high in the cliffs, with no ladder, just bare rock. Perfect fortress. Nothing can reach her up here, except the occasional curious pterodactyl. But the cave's entrance was not wide enough for this beast to come inside. In the distance, beyond the storm, clear skies move towards her. She sees the rain would be ending soon enough. The temperatures would rise. It would be a perfect day to hunt. The woman left the front door open and went back inside to stand beside her makeshift bed, unmoving. She stood like this, eyes closed, breathing controlled, until the rain stopped 2 hours later. When the sun shone in the cave's door, she came alive again. The woman dropped to one knee and gathered supplies, stuffing them into a homemade leather backpack. A large tooth hollowed out into a bowl, a smaller one as a cup, some bone utensils and a few strips of smoked meat. She stands and throws the bag on her back, feeling at her pants pocket for the familiar square shape she kept in there. She felt comforted knowing her most important tool was on her at all times. She headed for the door, glancing to a side wall at her collection of bone and wood spears. She would not use them. She was in that kind of mood. Anything she killed today, she would kill by hand. She hoped she would come across a raptor. At 9 feet tall, they were the most fun to fight. The woman stepped out of the cave onto the ledge, closing the leather door behind her to keep the pterodactyls out, and started the long climb down. She moved fast, her steel-like fingers gripping the stone, brushing past the soon-to-be-extinct trees. 30 feet before she reached the ground, she stopped and listened, hanging by one hand, listening in case there was something near enough and big enough to cause her any fear. Hearing nothing, she jumped the rest of the way to the forest floor, landing on her feet. She walked to the river, gathering wood along the way, stopping as she reached the water's edge. A rustling across the river caught her attention. She waited and watched as a Tyrannosaurus rex poked its head out of the trees. She knew that if she stood still, the beast's beady eyes would not focus on her. But she didn't care. She turned back and dropped the wood into a pile. The dinosaur roared and stepped closer, stopping at the water's edge. The water was only a few feet deep, yet the dinosaur, with the brain the size of a pea, didn't know that. After a few minutes, it wandered away. The woman began her morning ritual, emptying her backpack, taking the tooth bowl to the river and filling it with water. Back at the campsite, she knelt down and removed a small tablet-like device from her pants pocket. She popped off the device's back cover and removed its infinite battery. She pulled her hair from her own head, licked it wet, and wrapped it around one of the pieces of wood. She held each end of the hair to the power terminals of the battery. The hair glowed red, and the wood caught fire. With the fire going, she put the tooth bowl near the flame, stood, and went to gather some pine needles. By the time she returned, the water was boiling, so she put the pine needles into the tooth cup, added the water, and let her tea simmer. Chewing on some of her dried meat, sipping her pine tea, she enjoyed these quiet times. When she was finished, the woman put the battery back into the tablet, turned it on, and checked the charge level. It was at 36%. In another few years, it would reach 50%, which is what she needed to get home. Home to the family she had lost. Home to the man who died for us all. The woman sat looking into the distance, lost in thought. How long had it been? She didn't count days anymore. She counted winters. 16 of them so far. 16 years as the world's only woman. 16 years as the world's only human. A single tear rolled down her cheek as she thought about him. The only man she ever loved. The man who made her promise to save the world as he lay dying in her arms. Here, on her very first try, she failed him. Her thoughts ended in a flash when her tablet started beeping. She jumped to her feet and looked at the device's screen. 3 dots appeared in its upper right corner. 3 more tablets were nearby. Her time had come. With an evil smile, she left everything but the tablet behind, as she charged off into the direction of the 3 little dots. Today, she would kill that son of a bitch who killed the world. Today, she would change the future. Well, that's the introductory chapter to my book. I would appreciate real opinions if you have one. Thanks for watching.